Yeah.
And now, our feature presentation.
So let's bring on our beloved brother minister, Louis Farrakhan. Let's bring him on.
Assalamu alaikum. In the name of Allah, who came in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, the one God to whom all praise is due, the Lord of the world. We thank Allah for blessing us with our beloved leader, teacher, and guide, the messenger of Allah, the most honorable Elijah Muhammad. Brothers and sisters, I am very thankful to Almighty God Allah for your presence here this evening. I hope that before you leave, or when you leave, you will say that I'm happy for having gone to Muhammad's temple. I'm going to say this to you. You should never wait to learn whether I'm going to be here before you come out and fill up the temple.
Yes, sir.
That's quite unfair to truth. Though we understand that like all human beings, we like or we have our preferences. When a person is sick and death is at the doorstep, they don't care who administers the medicine. Object is, get me well. When we are halfway well, we figure that we can afford to go to the doctor of our choosing. But when emergency strike, anyone will do. My dear brothers and sisters, I want you to learn to love the truth wherever it is and from whomever it comes. You must not permit personalities to confuse you, or that you become confused with personality and truth. Now, why am I saying this? Because men live and men die, but truth is eternal. And if we train our minds to search for truth and reason with truth, and seek truth, truth will come up from beneath your feet, come out of the mouth of babies. It will come from brother today, sister tomorrow. It may even come out of the enemy's mouth. When your ear is tuned for truth, then your ear is listening for right guidance. And when you hear it, you will recognize it. But if you are only looking for a particular person to tell you the truth, and if that person is not there, well, I won't come out of, if that person is not coming, I'm not sure whether I want to be there. I think we have played the truth cheap, and we have put a person above the beauty of truth. There are stars that shine brighter than others. There are men who reflect truth. greater than others. However, the object is not to compare who reflects truth more than another, who shines more brilliantly than another. The object is get the truth. I mean, does that make sense? So I'm saying to the brothers and sisters, you know, you always fill the temple. Don't ever let me look at empty seats, because wisdom should never be wasted. Not that it is wasted on you, because you are certainly worthy of it, but you know, there are so many jewels of knowledge dropped in simple settings like this, that after it is said, we wish that thousands or millions could have heard it. So I'd like to talk to you tonight about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Something that's in my heart that I want to express about this man. Now, many people want to hear the truth. And I just got through saying that we shouldn't associate personalities with the truth. Or we shouldn't take personalities above the truth. But there can be no truth except that there is someone to tell it. There won't be a lie except there is a liar. Therefore, truth will not come except someone tells it. When a people are in need of truth, God doesn't send truth just floating on the air. He always raises a man. But when Allah raises up a man to tell the truth, that man must have a heart committed totally to the truth. That man's heart, I want you to listen carefully, that man's heart must be so totally committed to the truth that his tongue will refuse to tell a lie. For God will never choose a liar to bring forth his message of truth. Therefore, when Allah finds one worthy to bear a message of truth for a people who need the truth, that man whom God's choice falls upon is not a liar. God never has sent a liar to the people. Therefore, the word that the scholars use for prophet in Arabic is called Nabi. And that word means a source from which one can drink without fear of pollution, contamination. What is coming from that source is holy, meaning it is not mixed, it is not tampered with, it is not diluted in any form. That is why prophets of God, messengers of God, are the most noble and worthy men. They are associated with the truth and inseparable from the truth, for they are the vessels of the truth. Am I making myself clear? And you say, what does that got to do with me as a black man in America, or a black man in the Caribbean, or a black man on the face of the earth in this time? The black man is not suffering from the white man. The black man is suffering from his ignorance of the white man and of himself. Listen, brother, I want you to listen. The white man can do no more to you than what you permit him to do through your ignorance of him and of yourself. So therefore, your greatest enemy is not white or black. Your greatest enemy is the ignorant condition of your mind. I want you to listen now. As long as you say, oh, whitey, oh, that nigger this, or that nigger that, see, you're skirting the real issue. The real issue is that you and I are fools. And because we have been fools or foolish, we have permitted others to make merchandise of us. Therefore, in order to eradicate oppression, in order to eradicate slavery, in order to erase totally colonialism, exploitation, all one needs is truth. And once we are filled with knowledge, there are things that knowledge will not permit us to take. You understand? Knowledge will cause us to refuse to bow, to yield. So when you give a man knowledge, the very nature in which man is created is that his body must bow to the dictates of knowledge. So all you got to do is give a man knowledge, that's it. And that man will rise up and be formed according to what he knows. Listen now. Listen. Everybody all right? Okay, just relax. Everything's going to be all right. We just want to talk about a man. Now, you know when you take clay from the side of a mountain or from wherever you get it, and you are a potter, the clay has no power to resist you. So you form and fashion the clay according to what is in your mind. One day I was talking with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and he said to me, "Brother, never get proud . He said, "Always be humble and remember that it is wisdom that has formed you." I went home and I reflected on what he said. He said, "Don't get proud. I don't care what kind of accolades and honor people give you. Don't strut about. Be humble. Because they are praising the form that wisdom puts you in. Because when I was a fool, I spoke like a fool. I acted like a fool. I thought like a fool. Therefore, I was treated as a fool. But what is the difference between the foolish man that I was and the man that I am becoming? It is the shape of wisdom." Listen now. "A man that I met gave me knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. And that wisdom, knowledge, and understanding began to form me according to itself." Now you listen. Every man is formed according to his work and the knowledge that he puts into his work. Listen now. You see a policeman? He's studying criminal investigation, studying crime. So he began to look like a, you know, that kind of man. Snarled all up some day. You can almost tell him everywhere you see him. Look at him. That's a policeman. And you got another man. You can almost tell a preacher wherever you find. Big gut, you know, head. Queasy looking. I mean, but everybody's marked and formed by the wisdom of their work. Now, if the wisdom that we are receiving from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is the wisdom of God, then if I submit to that wisdom will form you and me into God. So when you see a man being formed and fashioned by wisdom into God, and you marvel at him, isn't it wonderful? You say, what is wonderful? That form? Or is not the wonderful thing the fact that wisdom has come to take a shapeless fool and fashion him up now into a God? Now what are you talking about, Farrakhan? If you will agree with me, oh, never wet up the erasers like this, brother. Make it difficult. If we agree that the black man has labored for 400 years in ignorance and has been formed by ignorance, then look at the ugly shape that ignorance has got us in. I mean, just look. I mean, have you ever checked yourself out, brother? I mean, wait a minute. I'm not throwing no stone at you or me. But have you ever checked yourself out? I mean, just look at what we do. Look at what we say. Look at the path that we're walking on. I mean, is it a path that's directed according to wisdom, or really aren't we formed up by the ignorance of our thinking? Now, you want to blame everybody in the world, but today you got to blame yourself, because now you are a blessed man and a blessed woman. God has given us a teacher of truth and wisdom. And all you have to do is lend your ear to that man. That's all. And if you lend Muhammad your ear, the wisdom of God will come in and push foolishness out and then form you according to the majesty of that wisdom. And then an ugly man begins to look good. A foolish man begins to look wise. A weak man begins to look strong. All because in the wisdom of God is life, is power, is strength, it's right, it's exact. And therefore we become as exact, as right, as powerful, as full of the light of God as that which we have accepted into our minds to guide our lives. Does it make any sense? All right, now let's go a step further. A prophet is a man who gets what is called revelation. Now listen, brother. What is revelation? In the word revelation is the word reveal. And the word reveal means to uncover what is hidden. She wore a revealing dress. Revelation. But I always get to bring it home to you so you can understand. Am I right? Isn't that what they call a revealing dress? That what was hidden, that's right. Okay, it didn't mean that what was revealed was not there. What was revealed was present but couldn't be seen because it was covered. But to reveal means to uncover what is hidden that we may see it as it is. Understand now? Are you listening? Now, Brother, knowledge is all out here. We live in a house of knowledge. The universe is a house of knowledge. Everywhere you look up, down, or if you could look through, all you would see the diameter of the universe, 76 quintillion miles of truth. Well, then, if truth is all around us, then why have not we grasped the truth and made progress in our lives as an individual and collectively as a nation? It is because a veil has been dropped over the very eye of the black man, where he has been unable to see truth that is all around him, staring him in the face. He looks at it, but he doesn't recognize it because there's a veil between his eye and the object of truth. So revelation means you lift the veil off of the eye with knowledge and enable a man to see that which was hidden to his eye. That's beautiful. Now, why do you get such a thing? Why is revelation necessary? Are you all right? In the divine scheme of the evolutionary development of man, man is always evolving toward perfection. When man reaches an impasse, problems that he can't solve, then he reaches a plateau in his learning. He levels off and then he begins to sink or fall backwards. Are you all right? Yes, I don't want nobody sleeping. You come on, sleep out. Come on down over here and knock you in your mouth. Give me a brother with a stick up there. I'm only teasing you. I just do these kind of things to keep it interesting. You know how it is when you're in a classroom. Boy, if you had a teacher like this in school all the time, you'd be heavy now. But you know something? I'm going to tell you something. Teachers, whenever somebody sleeps on you, that's not their fault, it's yours. Okay, let's move on. Now, where was I? At what? Oh, everybody hollering out there. What kind of class is this? I just want to know, yes, doctor, where were we? Oh, yeah, you weren't asleep at all. That's how you check to see where everybody was, you know, was thinking. Now, don't you know, if you watch the rise and fall of nations and civilization, when man gets to as far as the extent of his own knowledge, knowledge is like a light. Have you ever seen a flashlight? You put a flashlight on the table in a dark room, there is a point where the light starts and there's a point where the light ends, because there's power in that light only to carry a certain distance. Now, if you're walking and the light is behind you, once you get to the end of that light, then there's darkness again. So if you keep on walking beyond your light, then you begin stumbling. Am I right? Yes, well, so it is with knowledge. Knowledge is the light of a man's mind. A man can see no further than his knowledge. And when he reaches the end of his knowledge, he begins to stumble. He reaches an impasse. He begins to deteriorate then. So out of the mercy of God, he is given a greater light to carry him another distance. I'm trying to make it simple as we can. Is it clear? All right. Moses had a light. The light from Moses, you just put Moses up here, because he was one of these kind of men that they call Nabi. You could drink from Moses. The man had truth. and his light was to last from himself for 2,000 years. After the people got up close to that 2,000 years, the light of Moses was to be replaced by the light of Jesus. And those who said, Moses is my man.
Look at now. I don't want to hear no Jesus. Moses is my man. Who this Johnny come lately coming on here with this brassy truth? Now, I don't dig what he's saying because I'm a Moses man. So those who didn't pick up the torch because Jesus and Moses were brothers. They were from the same God. So a man wasn't denying Moses by accepting Jesus. He was only picking up a light from Jesus that would extend his light and enable him to walk 2,000 more years. But when they rejected Jesus, they went into darkness right there. And they suffered because of their rejection. Now, what am I saying? Here you and I are. We've been in America for 400 years. And the light has been put out in the black man's eye. You are not functioning from the light of Moses, and you are not functioning from the light of Jesus. Even though you may believe in Jesus, you were not able to get light out of what that man was saying. Otherwise, you wouldn't be stumbling and running into one another. So here we are in the dark. Right? Civilization now has reached a peak and is now teetering on the brink of disaster. Look at it, brother. Whitey is a magnificent technological giant. Isn't he? Look at the building that he's able to put up, the bridges. Look at his skill in electronics, his brilliance in aviation, in aeronautical skill, in navigational technique. The man is a wizard. But look at him in common terms of humanity. So all that Whitey has built now is teetering on the brink of disaster because he has not learned that material things must be supported by spiritual values. Listen to your brother. I don't care what you attain in life, you cannot support your fine material accomplishment in hatred and strife with your brother. For it is wars that tear down civilization. So as a man builds materially, man must learn to build morally, build spiritually, so that his relationship to his fellow man will be secure. And in the security of man relationship, brother relationship, we can perpetuate and maintain what we build. Now the Arabs and the Jews are at it. China's free and she got her guns ready. The whole world has reached a point now of bloody disaster. Men are stumbling around, not able to find solutions to simple problems as to where or who does this land belong to. Nations are arguing over their rights to the sea. 200 miles out from the shore, this is all mine. Nobody seems to have the ability to reason anymore. Their light is gone. You can tell that their light is gone because they're clashing and colliding with one another. If you can see, brother, you see around obstacles, not bump into them. Huh? Whitey has gone blind. His knowledge has run out. Yeah, all praise is due to Allah. He's gone. Now, if you and I are to survive, we cannot permit the white man in his fall to be our advisor. We have got to have an advisor from God.
Now, we're in the world. We see what's happening. You know, hazy, though. It's very hazy. We say, wow, man, something's happening. This is the way you talk. I don't know what's going on. You write a song, what's going on? What's going on? I mean, you know something is going on, but you don't know what. Why are you saying what's going on? Because you can't see. You can sense. You can feel, but you can't see. What do you need? Revelation. See? You need to have a veil removed from your eyes that you may see clearly what is around you and then be rightly guided. And that's the inestimable value of a divine messenger of God. The wisdom of a messenger is not common. You can go to the library and get a book. I'm reading a book on economics. Oh, yes. There's a law of diminishing returns. So after you get finished reading the book, you think you can apply the principle. Now, Whitey's sitting in Washington. He's a master of economics, but he can't balance his budget. See, so what he needs can't be found in his own textbook. And if you're reading the same book that Whitey's reading and confused over, then the light of your life can't be found in Freud. It can't be found in Socrates and Plato. It can't be found in Machiavelli and Nietzsche. You got to go somewhere to find the knowledge that you need. And if it were in the books, he would have found it. He needs revelation, and you do too. Now, when revelation comes, is everybody all right? Me too, I feel pretty good. Look. Yeah, it really is amazing. If you had seen me just a half hour ago, you would have said, my Lord, what happened to the minister? You can be tired, but you know, the spirit of Allah that is in his wisdom just rejuvenates the man. Let me go on. Listen. You know, there's such a thing as common water. Water that's common. You can drink it out of the tap, you know. You can get it here or there. It's common. It's easy for us to get to it. But there is a water that comes from above that many areas of the earth would love to see today. They scan the sky looking for clouds with some water in it. That water that comes from above is the best of all. Why is that water better than the common water that you find? Because as that water is drawn up from the surface of the earth, as Messenger Muhammad teaches us, the sun and the moon have an attracting power on that water. Yes, sir. Pulls it right up from the earth, but as it's drawn closer and closer to the sun, it is purified of the impurities that are in the water. And then when she comes down, she's pure. She comes from above. Now, revelation is always seen scripturally as coming down. Notice it? And God sent the book down. So many of us in our stupidity say, yeah, man. Cat threw a book out of the sky, you know? Can you imagine thinking that the sky opened up and a book came floating down? It is not that at all. What is meant there, brothers and sisters, as the messenger teaches us, is that as one of us is selected, chosen, by Allah to deliver truth to a people who are in need of that truth. That wisdom comes from God, who is above us spiritually, mentally, morally, and in power. Not that he's up off the earth somewhere, right on the earth with us, but he's above us in the level of his thinking. As the scripture says, my thoughts are not yours. My ways are not yours. Mine are from above, while yours are from beneath. So when wisdom comes from God, it is said to come down. But when it comes down, it is always rained down on a people who don't have it. It's very beautiful if it's understood. As clouds are formed by raising it up from the earth, this is the way God makes a messenger for you. He raises him up from the people. And as he draws him up from the people, not physically pulling him up, but calling him out from among the people, then he fills that man's head with revelation or wisdom that we hadn't thought of before, but it's here. And when that man begins to reveal that truth, it opens your eyes right up, opens your ears up, opens your mind up, and you begin to see what you didn't see, hear what you didn't hear, and then you begin to walk in a different way. Now, all of that brings me to the very heart of my subject, a man, Elijah Muhammad. This man is so valuable to the black people. What is hidden? Now, as Nabi means a source from which you can drink, free from all contamination, then every messenger or prophet of God is in himself a book for the people. That's where I was going. That's where I was going. Every messenger or prophet is in himself a book. And you know how books are. Some books don't have fancy covers. Some books don't look like they're too tough. Some people just don't care to read. So they will look at the book and walk by the book. The Holy Quran in the second chapter opens up like this. I, Allah, am the best knower. Very beautiful. Aleph Lamin. I, Allah, am the best knower. He's announcing himself to us. He's saying, whatever knowledge is in the world, I am the best, not a better knower. I am the best knower. Meaning that if you will take what I give you, you will know better than anyone else and you'll be more perfectly guided. For I am the best knower. Then he says, this book, there is no doubt in it. It is a guide to those who keep their duty or who guard against evil. Look at now, stop there a minute.
I got it.
What book? If it's a book written by the best knower, I want to read it. I don't go for reading too much, but if the best knower wrote it, please let me read it. Because I'm in bad shape because I don't know. One prophet said, my people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. How are we destroyed? For the lack of what? Knowledge. And here's a man announcing himself saying, I, Allah, am the best knower. Well, that's the end of your being destroyed. All you got to do is find the book that the best knower wrote and say, let me read. All right. This book Some say, oh, you mean Holy Quran?
No. I don't mean Holy Quran.
This book has been lying around for the last 1,400 years. Men have read it and done well, because the words in it are from Allah. But reading Allah's words and not being able to understand them means you can't practically apply them, so they're of no value to you. No. When you go to school, you don't only get a book, you get a teacher. Come on. The teacher may tell you, look, I want you to pick up your textbook, and this is the textbook for this course. But he don't tell you, go home and I'll see you in the spring for your final examination. No, he don't say that. He guides you through your studies, because there are things that you're going to come across in the book that you don't understand. Therefore, the teacher is as important to you as the book. In fact, he's more important if he knows the book. Are you all right now? Now, the Holy Quran talks about a messenger that would be coming to us in the last days. I'd like to read to you what it says. Give me a minute. Let me. Oh, brothers and sisters, it's so pretty, so pretty. You know, knowledge is pretty. It really is beautiful. Oh, I hope I can find it. Thank you, brother. He said, take your time, you'll find it. And I hope, what is it? No. I'll quote it. I can't find it right now. I'll quote it. But it's talking about the messenger that God would give to us. And our Lord raise up in them a messenger from among themselves, and recite to him thy messages, and teach him the book and the wisdom, that he may recite it to them and purify them. See that the book now is not for you. The book is for the messenger. And the messenger is for you. And God gives the messenger the understanding of the book, and the messenger becomes the book of the people. But they must hear what comes out of his mouth and read what he says and dig in. And if they do, they will be able to guard against evil, and they will be able to keep their duty, and they will be able to grow up into God. Now, I'm going to conclude. It's not necessary to take a lot of time. It's really just necessary to say what needs to be said. On Wednesday night in Brooklyn, I don't know how many of you were there. How many were there in Brooklyn Wednesday? Oh, here you were there. Now, I was trying, excuse me. Thank you, they gave me the verse, but I've quoted it already, so. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Now, boy, you know, thank you. But, you know, after the thing is passed, it's not no sense in bothering me with it. I think he threw me off. But anyway, I was trying in Brooklyn to get our people to see that for every physical thing, it has its relationship in the spiritual world. And so many of our people do not want to deal on a spiritual level. And as long as you refuse to listen or reason with spiritual wisdom, do you know you limit your power even to deal in the physical? Because the power to really deal in the physical comes from the spiritual. Let's understand now. I made a picture from the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad of the earth. Y'all all right?
Yes,
okay. I'm just checking on you. It's Friday night. We usually go somewhere and get drunk. You know how it is. So tonight we might as well get high off of knowledge. Yeah, you'll be all right. If you stag out of here tonight and they arrest you, just tell them, yes, I'm high. You can smell my breath and check my veins. You won't get it till you check my brain. All right, now. Y'all all ready to go into this? All right, let's go to the earth now. Now, Messenger Elijah Muhammad, who is the supremely magnificent teacher and instructor, he has taught us that the earth is 7,926 miles in diameter, 24,896 miles in circumference, 196,940,000 square miles, 57,255,000 square miles of earth coming up out of water, and 139,685,000 square miles of water. Now that's a mighty earth. And she weighs 6 sextillion tons. It's a heavy planet, brother. Now don't talk about you too heavy to move. Check the earth out. And she weighs 6 sextillion tons. You can't move if you weigh that much. But yeah, it is right. Now, if you look at the earth, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad says, no matter what you think, study the earth, he says. He's giving us the actual facts of the earth for us to learn something. That heaven for you is not on Mars, on Jupiter, on Uranus, or Pluto, or Mercury. Heaven for you is in the earth that you came up and out of. You're standing on the earth, and white folks told you to look up for your heaven. While Messenger Muhammad said, heaven is beneath your feet. Now, let's read what he said. Heaven is beneath your feet. This is a powerful word. I hope that Allah will bless me to drop on you tonight. I hope it'll make you a better person. And me too. Listen. The earth that we walk on is our home. We come up out of the earth. And I don't care how long you stay topside. Sooner or later, you got to go back. There ain't no use in running off the planet. Because you can't live nowhere else. So, the more you run right back into the earth where all of us came from, where all of us must return. There's a spiritual lesson in there. I'm going to tell you in a minute. The heaven that is for man, like the scripture says, in my Father's house, there are what? Many what?
Mansions.
What you doing? Living in this nasty, bummy-looking apartment, talking about in my Father's house, there are many mansions. What is your Father's house? Well, when I get to heaven, I'm going to put on my shoes. You don't need no mansion up there. There's no material up there to build one. Your Father's house is here. 24,896 miles. That's your Father's house. And yours too. And every mansion that man wants to build is right under his foot. But man has to learn how to go into the earth and get out of the earth what is already there for his good. How long have our brothers in Africa walked around topside, not recognizing the value of what was under their feet? And Whitey came in and took what was beneath their feet and built a heaven for himself on earth. You know, you may say white folks are wrong. Wait a minute now. But I heard the Honorable Elijah Muhammad say something Savior's Day that caused me to think. And I'm going to repeat it to you. You may say the white man was wrong for coming over here, taking the country from the Indians. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad asked a penetrating question. What was the Indian doing? They have a dude ain't doing nothing but hunting buffalo. What the hell he need a country for? I mean, now you stop and reason it out. You claim it's yours, but if you don't do something with what you have, somebody will move in and take it because you don't recognize the value of what you got. And that's why somebody got your woman. That's why the white man got your earth. And that's why you walking around here poor, ragged, hungry, naked, and out of door talking about how somebody did you. And no, nigga, you too dumb. You did yourself it. All right. You go on. Jamaica's a rich country. White folks saw bauxite there. They know that they need bauxite to make aluminum. You wasn't doing nothing with the bauxite. They come in, so-and-so, I will give you jobs, and I will do this, I will do that. Let me have the bauxite. So, okay, they got the bauxite. Now you're waking up. You say, hey, man, what's going on here? Now, when you realize the value of what you got, then you fight for your own. When you realize the value of your woman, you don't let nobody get to your woman. When you realize the value of your earth, then you fight for your piece of ground. But as long as you don't know the value of what you got, anybody that can value it more than you will take it away from you. From a woman right on through. He took my woman from me. That nigga came in and got my woman. You're damn right he got her. What was you doing with her? Well, that ain't the point. That is the point. If it's your woman, then love her. Take care of her. Don't let nobody get to her. She ain't going to nobody if you know the value of what you got. Simple? Simple, isn't it? Let's go on now. The Arabs walking around on the desert with a Holy Quran. Head wrapped up in linen. Riding on their camel with their holy book. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Whitey said, let them sing. Let them sing that God is the greatest. I know he is. And man, I've got a great land there, boy. All that oil is under the sand. So Whitey came in and said, hey, I want to drill here. I said, help yourself. I ain't doing nothing. God is there. Jill, I'm reading. Don't bother me. I'm into the 110th surah of the Holy Quran. So white folks got the oil now. And now that the Arabs have realized the value of what they have fought for it and got it back, and now they are becoming powerful. But they could not blame England. They had to blame themselves because they placed no value on what was beneath their feet.
Are you listening? All right. Now, you listening? Listen, brother. Anything that a man wants is in the earth.
All that you could envision to build the material for it
is in the earth.
And all we have to do is have some earth and then learn what to do with the earth after we have it. All right. That's the physical plane, isn't it? Now let's go deal with the spirit. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad says that Islam is the spiritual home of the black man. Just like the earth, he comes up out of the earth and he must return to the earth. Islam means to submit to the will of God, and it is the natural way of life of the black man. And since we came from Islam, then it's only a matter of time. I don't care how far you run or where you hide, when you come in contact with Islam, your days of running are numbered. It's only a matter of time before you come home, because Islam is your home. And in it is all that you need to build the unity, the brotherhood, the power that is necessary to go into the earth and build a heaven for yourself. Therefore, when God gives to the people a messenger or prophet, that man is to the people as the earth is. You got to study it. Then you got to go into it. Don't be a surface dweller. Oh, are you listening?
Yes.
The people who followed Moses, many of them didn't try to understand the man. They just kept saying, Moses, I'm following Moses. But they ended up so messed up. Some others had to come and inherit the promised land, because they were too dumb to recognize the value of what was in Moses. Moses was a man, but in him was everything that Israel needed for a nation. They didn't have to go to a library. They didn't have to go anywhere. Just go to Moses and drink from what the man was teaching and learn what was in his teaching and go build. In Moses himself was the germ of a nation. And from Moses came a nation. All right. Now Allah gives you a man and me a man. Whether you like it or not, you have Elijah Muhammad, the last of the messengers of God. He's yours and mine. I want you to listen now. Please listen. Elijah Muhammad, that's right. He said, talk about my Savior. Here's a brother from Puerto Rico. He says Elijah Muhammad is his Savior. Here's a brother from Jamaica. He says Elijah Muhammad is his. Here's another from Africa. He says Elijah Muhammad is his. He belongs to the black man. All right, now. You all right? Now we're going to close it out. That man, Muhammad, is the spiritual earth of the black man. In him is riches, untold wisdom, power. It's in him. You know what that man has been put through for the last 43 years? I studied it. And one day I went to the messenger and I was talking about his suffering and comparing it to the earth. You see the earth groaning under tremendous pressures. And you wonder, why is the earth subjected to all of these forces? But if it were not for these forces, the rising in temperature, the lowering of temperature, the swelling of the earth, the contracting of the earth, you would not get oil in one place, diamonds in another, gold in another. It is what the earth goes through in its motion that makes it richer. So when Allah puts a messenger of God through all kinds of trial and tribulation, you say, well, why does God do that? He's making the man richer in substance for you to draw from it. I don't know whether you are listening to me. Now we got a
coming, standing.
Now we got a man in our midst that's putting wisdom out as never a man has put before men in the past. And many of us are like the man that is called a savage, walking around with a grass skirt, living in some grass hut, and beneath his foot is the substance to build a palace. Brother and sister, if you don't benefit from the teaching of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, it's nobody's fault but your own, because his teaching is full. But you got to respect the man, not just his message. You got to respect the man. And if you love the man, you understand that you have to be careful how you treat the earth, because the earth will retaliate against you. Ask the farmer. He go plowing in the earth, he plant a seed, the earth bring him up something. He doesn't understand how to treat the earth. It's topsoil. So he wears that part of the earth out. Then when he goes back, there's nothing there for him. You got to understand a divine messenger of God. You can't mistreat him and expect to draw from him after you mistreat him. Once we begin to mistreat the messenger, we are cut off. Just like there's a certain part of the earth that may be dry where it used to be fertile, and another place fertile where it used to be dry, then Allah will start drying you up where you are and making others flow with abundance because they have respect for the man, the earth, the spiritual earth from which we live. Do you hear what I'm saying? Now, just like you got to go into the earth and get out of the earth, you got to go into a book and get out of the book what is in the book. Now, if a man is a book, and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad have met with the best knower, and the best knower has taught the man, then when the Holy Quran says, this book, there is no doubt in it. It ain't talking about a book, it's talking about a man. This man, there is no doubt in him. He's a guide to any one of you who want to guard against evil, who want to grow in wisdom and power. He is a guide for you. Don't doubt him. Drink from him. Drink and drink deep. If you come to him with doubt and suspicion, then when you open the page, you say, well, what is this? Like you do in the book of favor. Well, I guess I'll check this book out. You know what I mean? See what kind of book it is. That's the way you treat Muhammad. I'll check this dude out. But when you check him out with your own bias and prejudices in mind. The things that you've heard, the propaganda you've read. So when you look at him, it's like scanning a book that you don't dig the cover, and the subject matter is not appealing to you. Therefore, you walk by the book. You know how Whitey sells books now? I was laying in the bed last night, and I had the TV on. I wasn't looking at it. I just heard it. We're talking about a book, and the heartbeat.
hit this book. It is the, you know, it's the greatest book you have ever read. Its experience will shock you. People.
So people say, wow. Oh, find that book, man. See, but the Honorable Elijah Muhammad don't come to you with no fanfare. He don't come all dressed up in fancy clothes and fancy terms. He comes to you plain and simple, just like your brother, and that's why you walk by him. Many people have walked by good earth because it was plain and simple. Here's a book, Muhammad. And I'm going to close now. Once I realized that he himself was the book. He didn't tell me that. He didn't tell me that. But I grew to realize it. Then I said, let me open the book and study from his page. Now you know something? I'm going to tell you. Everywhere I go today, and I hope you don't think I'm being boastful or other than myself, but you know something? It's frightening, but people begin to admire you. They don't realize what made you. They just admire you. But when they admire you, they are bearing witness to the power of the book that you're reading from. If you had met me yesterday, there would be nothing to admire. Then if you met me today and admire me, why yesterday you never could, then what happened between yesterday and today? I met a man. I don't want to be no surface reader and admire the cover. I see a lot of you admiring the messenger's face. His face is beautiful. His skin, it reflects the beauty of the man internally. So we stop at the skin. We stop at the face. We stop at the beauty of the man physically, but we don't go inside the book to get a glimpse of the man spiritually, which is the real man. If you love the messenger, you don't love just a face, because the messenger is the bearer of a message. How are you going to love the messenger and not study the message, which is the messenger? Am I making any sense to you? So as I conclude this, I see him as the earth for me. I came up out of Muhammad. You understand? There was no Farrakhan until he came up out of Muhammad, and Muhammad named him. And Muhammad claimed him because he came from Muhammad, and without Muhammad, he could never have been.
Right.
So now I'm standing up on an earth that supports me.
Yes, sir.
I'm standing on Muhammad. I'm not here of myself. I talk strong. I feel strong. But the strength is not mine. It's coming from what I'm depending on for my strength. Just like a nation depends on its coal to fire its furnaces, to burn that iron ore and make it into steel. Like a nation depends on its oil and its natural gas coming from the coal to light its generators, to turn the lights on in the city and give power to the city. They depend on the earth. I depend on Muhammad. And I draw from that man. You don't see me drawing. You just hear a man talking. But I'm drawing. It's just like there's a hose
And I'm drawing like a well, pumping up wisdom from beneath me. Meaning I'm standing on Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
And what's coming out of my mouth is like a wall of water from beneath. And all you see is the water coming out. You said, dig that pump. But now dig the earth that the water is coming up out of. Now, see, it's hard for you to understand. But I want you to understand. Because you are the people that worship the seen and negate the unseen. And you take the unseen as the unreal. Just because you don't see Muhammad, that don't mean he don't exist. You see the earth, but you don't see the law that upholds it. But the law is there. The power is there. You see Muhammad, but you don't see the God that backs Muhammad. Then Muhammad puts us out, and you see us, but you don't see Muhammad. He stands back, but he's the power behind us all. This is what I was getting to all night long. Here's a man with revelation. The wisdom that Elijah Muhammad is dropping on you, if you just take it, it will open up to you everything that you couldn't see or understand yesterday. But after you're opened up, for God's sake, don't close up. Now you got the book open, why close it? Since you haven't finished reading it, put a marker in there. And go on back and pick it up where you left it off. Now I'm going to leave you. I realize this is the most difficult truth to accept. But it's not difficult for me to tell. My brothers and sisters, I wouldn't lie to you or deceive you to try to make you my brother or sister. For when you found out the truth, you would only leave me and then hate me for lying to you. But if I tell you the truth, even though you don't want it or don't accept it, it's immaterial with me, I must tell it. You see, and to tell a truth that shatters your thinking and focuses your mind on the real object, well, that's what is needed. Running around here looking at money. Look at you. Here's money. $2. Anybody still pull some money out and say, man, can't got money. What the hell is this but paper, man? This is not the real value. The real value is what you're walking on, and that's what you don't pay attention to. The earth. And that's why Whitey fights for the earth. He can have nickels and dimes and dollars, but it's the earth that gives value to everything. You walk by Muhammad, but he's the man. You accept his students, but he's the man. He gives value to us all. Now, I study him. One day we did a television show called Minister for Black Soul. Tony Brown did it on Black Journal. And when the messenger saw that, he saw me going out among the brothers and sisters who are on drugs. And the brothers and sisters looked so terrible, so in bad shape. And as I was talking to them, you could see them changing right before their eyes, right on the camera. Brother didn't have no clothes on, but the magnificent message of Muhammad made him see that he was standing in the presence of something that he should respect. So he began putting his clothes on, putting his cigarette out right on camera. And when the messenger saw it, the tears rolled down his eyes. And when he saw me, he said, oh, brother. He said, you certainly have a way with the people. I said, no, dear apostle. I said, it is not my way. I have studied you, and it is your way. Now, I was in a studio doing the television show yesterday. some very beautiful people were there. Very beautiful people. Black brothers and sisters who love black and want good for black. I don't know what they were thinking of me, but if I could read their thoughts, one thing they admired was humility. I didn't come in there thinking I was no big shot or acting like one. And in their heart, I could see that they saw this and they appreciated it. They liked it. Therefore, they liked the person. But I learned this from the book that I'm reading.
Right.
See, Muhammad is the humble one. And if I'm going to follow Muhammad, I got to try to get rid of all vanity and false pride and feeling all puffed up over what I'm not doing anything but following the guidance of a book. So if any credit is to be given, give credit to the book that we read that makes us like we are. So what came out of my mouth on this television show? My sister and brothers, they admired it. But it was not my words. These were the words of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I know what you're going to say, yeah, but you were speaking them. Yes, that's my gift. God gave me the gift. But without the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, you couldn't see that gift. I would be using it to talk trash. I would be using it to talk to a woman in a filthy way rather than to speak words of comfort and hope and guidance. How to do it? I'm reading a book, man. I'm reading a book. And because I try to practice what I read in the book, I'm successful. And then some of my dumb brothers and sisters envy me while the book is here for you to read also. Listen, as I was leaving the restaurant, the fish house, one of the brothers who was on drugs came to me and said, "Brother Farrakhan, I want you to know that you've got a strong soldier standing here behind you." He was telling me how much he loves me. And he's a soldier. And I said to him, "I feel very honored, brother, that you would say that you were great soldier behind me, but I will be a very happy man when you take your place out in front of me." Now there was a lot of wisdom in what I said. The brother on drugs, he's quick to pick up. And they started talking to each other. "Is it being that man? Is he being that? Is he being that?" They were nodding, but they wasn't dumb now. Are you dig that, brother? Now, what was I saying? The Honorable Elijah Muhammad told me, that this is what we represented. Nothing. But God didn't come and get in front of us. If he got in front of us, he would raise the level of nothing, but he would make nothing a fraction. He didn't want to make you a fraction. He wanted to make you whole. So instead of getting in front of you so that the people would see God, he got in behind you and put nothing out in front. Now, look at it. So if he put nothing out in front, then if he is God, he can reflect his power through nothing. And then raise the value. See, from nothing and that look like ten. But I know who I am, and I know what I am. I'm nothing without him. Behind me, backing me. me up, empowering me and guiding me. I'm reading a book. The brother who was on drugs came to me. He said, "Oh, Brother Farrakhan," says, "I love you." And I said, "Oh, brother, and I love you." He said, "Brother, you take care of yourself." Because he saw value in my life above his own. I said, "Oh, no, brother." I said, "You take care of yourself." Then he grabbed my hand and he kissed my hand. And he said, "Please get in your car before we all start crying out here. We're nothing but brothers on drugs. These ain't no chumps. These ain't no punks. These ain't no faggots. These are men, man. And they know a game when they see one. But here they were kissing my hand. And when he kissed my hand, I took his hand and I kissed his hand." I know I didn't do a wise thing, because the poison that's in the man's body is coming out of his pores, and I can feel the burning on my lips because I'm trying to live clean from reading that book. But I was not going to let him show me that he would do more for me than I was willing to do for him. Bow to me, and I will not bow back to you. Even down to the children, I do the same thing. You know where I got it from? I got it from the book that I'm reading. That's what I want you to understand. It's books that make men. And it's men that make books. But God made that book. And Muhammad just asked me to read it. And I'm trying to read the book. And I'm saying to you, when you look at Brother Farrakhan trying to exemplify some of the things that are found in the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, then if you marvel at your brother and you say, "Oh, isn't this something," then for God's sakes, go and read the book. There was a brother who came here yesterday all the way from Chicago to interview me. He sat in my office from WBBM or CBS Radio in Chicago for nearly 2 hours. He came hostile. He was nice, but, I'm here. You're the national representative, Mr. Muhammad. This is not what he said, but in his heart, you know. He could almost see this. So he told me point blank. He said, I don't believe that I should be restricted in asking you questions. I believe I should ask you whatever I feel like I want to ask you. And I told him, "You're right, brother." I was very humble. I said, "You're right, brother. You should ask me. So you ask me anything you want." When the interview started, he went to ask me. And I mean, he went all the way out in left field, and it looked like he got everything that he could find and threw it at me and looked me right in my eye. And as I begin to answer, I noticed the man change up. In the 2 hours that we were there together, the man had taken a complete change. And when he left, he was on a dinner date. And when he left, he wanted to bring his date back to dinner with me. He didn't want to leave me then. But it wasn't me that he didn't want to leave.
It was what I learned from the book I read, huh? And this is why I said, all of you, don't get jealous when you see a man being successful because he's trying to read a book. And first, before you pick up a book, you got to ask yourself, do I want to read it? Now, you don't go buying a book just because your friend got it. Hell, I don't want no book because you got it. I don't want Muhammad because you dig him. Hell no, I got to dig the man for myself. I ain't following Muhammad because he's giving me money to follow him. I'm following him because I checked him out. And I found him to be as exact and correct as God and as truth. I don't know nothing in him that's false. I don't know nothing. He's an awesome man and I'm terrified of him. And because I'm in awe of him, I approach my book with love and fear and humility. I never go before the messenger, even though I've been following him for 20 years. Stand up, brother. And say, how you doing? The Holy Apostle, I'm so glad to see you. Seen him for 20 years. Been blessed to go in and out of his house for 20 years. And I look at him today in more awe than I looked at him 20 years ago. And when I meet him, I'm like a child. Because I realize I'm standing in the presence of a book of God. My book. Damn it, I don't want to see nobody with a candle or a match in your hand around that sacred book. Look like you want to burn the page and I burn you. Don't look like you want to hurt my book. Lest I kill you outright. Murder you, brother. Murder you. That's my book. And when a wise man know he got a valuable book, he treasures the book. He holds the book up high. You don't carry wisdom down below your waist. You hold it up high. We hold Muhammad in esteem, not because he's just a man like us, but we hold him high because he's a book of wisdom from which we are learning with. Hold him up high. But I read in the parable in the Holy Quran about a jackass carrying book. You pile a lot of books on the back of a jackass, and at the end of a journey, he's still a jackass. So the book is on his back. He can't read. Saying that I love the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, not dig the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, is not enough. It is enough when you open the book and begin to read, and then try to practice and apply the principles that are found in that book. And they are the laws of success. And so everywhere that I have been blessed to go in the country representing him, the people, I've never seen anything like it, brothers and sisters. They melt before his wisdom. And I say this to you, if you want to help the messenger, if you want to help yourself and help your brothers and sisters, then study the man Muhammad. Try to carry into practice the principles that he so nobly exemplifies in the midst of us. He's not self-assuming. He's not trying to be grand or false. He's just right. Righteous, humble, meek, disciplined, firm, stern, yet human. Oh, what a beautiful man. And if I can capture just a portion of his beauty and reflect that portion of his beauty on a world filled with ugliness, then my living shall not be in vain. If I can make you see a man of God that the white man has blinded you to, that you may know that he is a divine messenger of God and come and live, then my lips shall not be in vain. And if I can represent to you a picture of a man that you long to see, but because he hides himself and reflects himself through nothing, he is not really seen as much as we would like to see him. And if I can give you a picture of his humility, a picture of his nobility, a picture of his ability, a picture of his grace, his charm, his wit, his humor, his wisdom, his power, his mercy, his endurance, his perseverance, then my living shall not be in vain. For when a man lives for the sake of vanity, he lives for himself exclusively. But when a man learns that himself is nothing, but it is his people and God that is everything, then he should live for others. And so I told the Honorable Elijah Muhammad last Friday, a week ago, that if I could not tell the world about him, I would rather be dead. For in reality, I don't see nothing worth living for than to introduce you to a book that will change your life, change your destiny, and make you the absolute marvel of civilization. So come on to your book. Come on to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Study the man. Study what he teaches. But approach the book properly. Approach the book properly. Don't handle the book until you're ready. A holy book is not like other books. A holy book, you don't touch it until you prepare your mind for that book. You wash yourself up, clean up, and you approach the book to study. And you focus and put your attention on it. So it is with the following of a divine man. Approach the messenger with humility. Approach the messenger with respect. Because he loves and respects you and is humble to you all. And if you come to that book, like the man who said that he would like to be at the feet of the master, then you open the book and watch how the book unfolds itself to you. And when that book unfolds itself, you take it in like food. And as the food goes down through your mouth, the esophagus, down into the stomach to be oxidized and passed on into the blood, that's the way you take the wisdom of Muhammad. Take it into your head, chew it, digest it. When you digest it, you're turning it over in your mind. And then let it become a part of you. And tomorrow, you will be better than you are today because you read the cover of the book. And if the cover of the book will make this kind of change in you, what will you be like when you read the first paragraph? Thank you for listening, and may Allah grant you the light of understanding as I greet you in peace. Salaam alaikum.
Brother Minister Farrakhan.
And I praise you for Allah. In the name of Allah and His Messenger, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad,
Very quickly, we'd like to ask you a few questions. Number one, how many are here for the first time, never been out to Muhammad's temple? All praise be to Allah. I want to thank you very much for coming out to the temple. Now, those of you who are here for the first time, how many of you believe what you heard from Minister Farrakhan, from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad tonight, to be the truth? Can I just see by raising your hand? Praise be to Allah. Now, how many would like to accept that truth and follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad? It costs you nothing. You just have to be black and brave. I'd like to see your hands. Just raise your hand. All praise be to Allah. Now, the brothers and sisters who would like to accept the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I would like to send you to the back to see the secretary. The secretary will give you the necessary information and come back to your seats, and we will be dismissed. Remember, it costs you nothing. All you have to do is be black and be brave. So those brothers and sisters who would like to get that information, please stand. Brothers, you go out to my left, go right out. Brother will show you to the back. Sisters, go right out to this side, and the sister will show you to the back. All praise is due to Allah. All praise is due to Allah. Okay, we have a few guests I'd like to I hope this is right when I read it. We have one distinguished guest with us. He's an outstanding Muslim, and I consider him an outstanding Muslim because he's a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and he's traveling around the world. He's in the world of entertainment, but he wants to preach Muhammad to his people. And he's in New York for a concert tomorrow night at, I think it's Carnegie Hall, is that right? Yeah. Brother Jimmy Cliff is here. Please stand, Brother Jimmy. And Brother Jimmy, is this right? You brought our five guests tonight? Yeah, he brought our five guests tonight. Thank you, well, God bless you. I want to thank Brother Jimmy very much. May Allah bless you and continue you to go on. And, you know, one of the sisters pointed out an article that the a devil had written in one of the New York magazines, and it was about the reggae music. And he mentioned Brooklyn and the music, and he mentioned Brother Jimmy. As a matter of fact, he had a picture of him in the article, and the picture was taken at Black Family Day. And though this particular devil knows that the brothers will follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he never mentioned that one time in the article. But the drift of the article seemed to try to show Brother James as being removed from his people, you know, and he used certain things. I have to show you the article, brother. Did you see it? Yeah? No. Well, it's a very interesting article because the devil stayed around us for a few days trying to get this article, and he attended the Black Family Day rally and heard every word that Minister Farrakhan said, and he knows for a fact that the brother is a Muslim. But he never mentioned that in the article at all, but said other things to make black people who were just on the surface, as the minister had mentioned, who were not digging in, to look at him as he couldn't be a Muslim because of his lifestyle. You know, tried to show him living in England. Why don't he live in Brooklyn, where more of the people from the islands are? But it's very shrewd. You know the devil I'm talking about? Jacobson, right? I'll show you the article, you know, before you leave town. Oh, you brought the members of your group, your band? All praise is due to Allah. Very good. Are they here? Are they still? Right, they're still out in the back? Okay. All praise is due to Allah and His Messenger. Very beautiful. There'll be a special meeting for all registered Muslims and processing Muslims. That means if you've taken out your forms, you're on your letters, tomorrow morning, we're having a unity meeting here at Muhammad's Temple, 9 a.m. sharp. That's what time we want to start. That means you be here at 8:30. 8:30 tomorrow morning here at Muhammad's Temple, we're having a unity meeting, very special meeting. Make sure you're out, and if there are brothers and sisters who are not out tonight, do not get the word, make sure you pass the word on to them. latest edition of Muhammad Speaks is in. Make sure you get a copy of that article by the messenger in this edition of Muhammad Speaks. Make sure you read it carefully. Very beautiful article. The latest edition is in. Make sure on your way out you get a copy. I think we have a few more record albums, Black Family Day, left. They are $2.50 on sale, seven speeches by Minister Farrakhan. And brothers and sisters who would like to get on the food in on the food co-op, stop in class from 6. You can get in on the food co-op, and you can get some instruction on how to join the food co-op. Classroom 2.
Yeah.
And now, our feature presentation.
So let's bring on our beloved brother minister, Louis Farrakhan. Let's bring him on.
Assalamu alaikum.
In
the name of Allah, who came in the person of Master Farad Muhammad, the one God to whom all praise is due, the Lord of the world. We thank Allah for blessing us with our beloved leader, teacher, and guide, the messenger of Allah, the most honorable Elijah Muhammad. Brothers and sisters, I am very thankful to Almighty God Allah for your presence here this evening. I hope that before you leave, or when you leave, you will say that I'm happy for having gone to Muhammad's temple. I'm going to say this to you. You should never wait to learn whether I'm going to be here before you come out and fill up the temple.
Yes, sir.
That's quite unfair to truth. Though we understand that like all human beings, we like or we have our preferences. When a person is sick and death is at the doorstep, they don't care who administers the medicine. Object is, get me well. When we are halfway well, we figure that we can afford to go to the doctor of our choosing. But when emergency strike, anyone will do. My dear brothers and sisters, I want you to learn to love the truth wherever it is and from whomever it comes. You must not permit personalities to confuse you, or that you become confused with personality. Therefore, I was treated as a fool. But what is the difference between the foolish man that I was and the man that I am becoming? It is the shape of wisdom. Listen now. A man that I met gave me knowledge, wisdom, and understanding. And that wisdom, knowledge, and understanding began to form me according to itself. Now you listen. Every man is formed according to his work and the knowledge that he puts into his work. Listen now. You see a policeman? He's studying criminal investigation. Studying crime. So he began to look like a, you know, that kind of man.
Snarled all up from that. You can almost tell him everywhere you see him. Look at him. That's a policeman. And you got another man, you can almost tell a preacher wherever you find him. Big gut, you know, head. Crazy looking. I mean, but everybody's mocked and formed by the wisdom of their work. Now, if the wisdom that we are receiving from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is the wisdom of God, then if I submit to that wisdom will form you and me into God. So when you see a man being formed and fashioned by wisdom into God, and you marvel at him, isn't it wonderful, you say? What is wonderful? That form? Or is not the wonderful thing the fact that wisdom has come to take a shapeless fool and fashion him up now into a God? Now what are you talking about, Farrakhan? If you will agree with me,
oh, never wet up the eraser like this, brother. Make it difficult.
If we agree that the black man has labored for 400 years in ignorance and has been formed by ignorance, then look at the ugly shape that ignorance has got us in. I mean, just look. I mean, have you ever checked yourself out, brother? I mean, wait a minute, I'm not throwing no stone at you or me, but have you ever checked yourself out? I mean, look at what we do. Look at what we say. Look at the path that we're walking on. I mean, is it a path that's direct except that there's someone to tell it? There won't be a lie except there is a liar. Therefore, truth will not come except someone tells it. When a people are in need of truth, God doesn't send truth just floating on the air. He always raises a man. But when Allah raises up a man to tell the truth, that man must have a heart committed totally to the truth. That man's heart, I want you to listen carefully, that man's heart must be so totally committed to the truth that his tongue will refuse to tell a lie. For God will never choose a liar to bring forth his message of truth. Therefore, when Allah finds one worthy to bear a message of truth for a people who need the truth, that man whom God's choice falls upon is not a liar. God never has sent a liar to the people. Therefore, the word that the scholars use for prophet in Arabic is called Nabi. And that word means a source from which one can drink without fear of pollution, contamination. What is coming from that source is holy, meaning it is not mixed. It is not tampered with. It is not diluted in any form. That is why prophets of God, messengers of God, are the most noble and worthy men. They are associated with the truth and inseparable from the truth, for they are the vessels of the truth. Am I making myself clear?
He said, what has that got to do with me as a black man in America or a black man in the Caribbean or a black man on the face of the earth in this time? The black man is not suffering from the white man. The black man is suffering from his ignorance of the white man and of himself. Listen, brother, I want you to listen. The white man can do no more to you than what you permit him to do through your ignorance of him and of yourself. So therefore, your greatest enemy is not white or black. Your greatest enemy is the ignorant condemned truth. Now, why am I saying this? Because men live and men die, but truth is eternal. And if we train our minds to search for truth and reason with truth and seek truth, truth will come up from beneath your feet, come out of the mouth of babies. It will come from brother today, sister tomorrow. It may even come out of the enemy's mouth. When your ear is tuned for truth, then your ear is listening for right guidance. And when you hear it, you will recognize it. But if you are only looking for a particular person to tell you the truth, and if that person is not there, well, I won't come out of. If that person is not coming, I'm not sure whether I want to be there. I think we have played the truth cheap. And we have put a person above the beauty of truth. There are stars that shine brighter than others. There are men who reflect truth greater than others. However, the object is not to compare who reflects truth more than another, who shines more brilliantly than another. The object is get the truth. I mean, does that make sense? So I'm saying to the brothers and sisters, you know, you always fill the temple. Don't ever let me look at empty seats. Because wisdom should never be wasted. Not that it is wasted on you, because you are certainly worthy of it, but you know there are so many jewels of knowledge dropped in simple settings like this, that after it is said, we wish that thousands or millions could have heard it. So I'd like to talk to you tonight about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Something that's in my heart that I want to express about this man. Now, many people want to hear the truth. And I just got through saying that we shouldn't associate personalities with the truth. Or we shouldn't take personalities above the truth. But there can be no tradition of your mind. I want you to listen now. As long as you say, oh, whitey, oh, that nigger this, or that nigger that. See, you're skirting the real issue. The real issue is that you and I are fools. And because we have been fools or foolish, we have permitted others to make merchandise of us. Therefore, in order to eradicate oppression, in order to eradicate slavery, in order to erase totally colonialism, exploitation, all one needs is
And once we are filled with knowledge, there are things that knowledge will not permit us to take. You understand? Knowledge will cause us to refuse to bow, to yield. So when you give a man knowledge, the very nature in which man is created is that his body must bow to the dictates of knowledge. So all you got to do is give a man knowledge. That's it. And that man will rise up and be formed according to what he knows. Listen now. Listen. Everybody all right? Okay, just relax. Everything's going to be all right. We just want to talk about a man. Now, you know, when you take clay from the side of a mountain or from wherever you get it, and you are a potter, the clay has no power to resist you. So you form and fashion the clay according to what is in your mind. One day I was talking with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and he said to me, "Brother, never get proud . He said, "Always be humble and remember that it is wisdom that has formed you." I went home and I reflected on what he said. He said, "Don't get proud. I don't care what kind of accolades and honor people give you. Don't strut about. Be humble. Because they are praising the form that wisdom put you in. Because when I was a fool, I spoke like a fool. I acted like a fool. I thought like a fool.